admit Puerto Rico as its 51st state through an act of Congress. So the USFG will admit Puerto Rico as its 51st state through an act of Congress. The agent of action is the USFG. The agent of enforcement is the USFG. Time frame will be immediately. Now under the solvency, it's just one that the USFG has accepted territories in the past as states. And for example, Hawaii was accepted as the 50th state after being a territory. So therefore, the USFG is able to do that. So with that, the advantage. So the economy. Uniqueness one is that 45% of the Puerto Rican population is currently in poverty right now. Uniqueness two is that Puerto Rico is actually in crippling debt, as $72 billion of debt actually have been accumulated through these past couple of years, and the government of Puerto Rico states that this is an extreme crisis and it is unable to deal with it in the current scenario. Uniqueness three is that as a territory, it is unable to file for bankruptcy and reallocate its budget for financial recovery. The ASA point under this is that with statehood, it'll be able to file for Chapter 9 bankruptcy, looking at Puerto Rican cities able to basically file for bankruptcy and get help, which will help it as a nation. And this method has actually saved cities like Detroit from a complete default. So what we see is that although it's falling back right now, we can still save Puerto Rico and primarily its cities through devastating defaulting, in which it'll lead to a complete collapse of investor confidence. Uniqueness four is that Puerto Rican unemployment is extremely high right now, as 13.7% of the locals actually struggle to find jobs because jobs simply don't exist, as Puerto Rico, with its corrupt government that is seeking rapid foreign investment that it's unable to pay right now, has like no strong regulations, and investor confidence is lost as the government itself is unable to like pay for these investments, and therefore that's the reason why it's in the debt crisis in the first place. So with that, the links. Link one is that the plan allows Puerto Rico to reallocate its budget by filing for bankruptcy and increases availability of a federal government bailout. Link two is that the plan opens up business investment in Puerto Rico under federal government oversight and regulation. The ASA point under this is that political and economic alignment with the rest of the 50 states ensures business confidence. So onto the internal links. Basically, this strong oversight by the U.S. federal government is actually key to investor confidence. What we see is that as the U.S. was actually able to accept Hawaii under statehood, it not only expanded from like a military base towards basically a pivot towards Asia and trade. In the same way, we can see by developing Puerto Rico under these U.S. laws and oversight, investor confidence can increase as the banks in Puerto Rico will be able to access direct bailouts from the U.S. federal government, and therefore, under the U.S. Federal government policy, investors will also have access to basically federal government loans, and they can basically sidestep this corrupt Puerto Rican government that is unable to allocate its budget correctly. So therefore, the increase of business investment and interest in Puerto Rico will increase offering these Puerto Ricans jobs. So with that, onto the impacts level. What we can see is that it will increase lives. Under this, like, dehumanization is currently, it'll make the quality of life better, okay? So right now, dehumanization is occurring in Puerto Rico as people simply can't get food or medicine that they need, as the government simply doesn't even have enough money to basically pay for its own expenditures. So therefore, dehumanization will be decreased as by filing for bankruptcy, the federal government can actually directly aid these people that are in need of aid. So therefore, we can stop this dehumanization and actually potentially death, which is the terminal impact in which these Puerto Rican citizens right now, as 45% of them, again, are in poverty, are able to actually access this food and medicine that they need desperately in the status quo. And the second impact is that boost in the economy will actually increase its GDP, leading to towards a future of a stronger economy and therefore better growth that will also basically increase its interconnectedness with the U.S., which will ultimately increase the availability of jobs in Puerto Rico, boosting its economy, which again will impact us lives. So with that, we can actually... The third impact is that we prevent economic collapse in Puerto Rico. So pretty much right now, the Puerto Rican economy is on the brink of collapse as It's crippling debt. It's not allowing further economic expansion, which means that it's key that we actually accept Puerto Rico as a state so the U.S. government can actually provide direct aid. Without such action, what we see is that the Puerto Rican economy will actually completely collapse, and it'll enter this collapse cycle as it'll further actually need this foreign investment to in order to pay for its debt right now, and therefore, like, this cycle is obviously not sustainable, which is why that we must solve for this issue right now. And on to the second ad, which is fairly quick, the tag will be democracy. So right now, Unicus 1 is that in Puerto Rico, as a territory, citizens in Puerto Rico are actually uniquely disenfranchised. Although they're considered U.S. citizens, they're actually unable to vote, and they can't pay federal taxes. So Unicus 2 under this is that without the ability to vote, Puerto Ricans are actually uniquely removed from the United States as a whole, and therefore have no political rights and are unable to actually help govern their own government in Puerto Rico. So the link to this is that the plan actually combines Puerto Rico with the United States and offers a more solid base of states' rights that are articulated under the Constitution, but territories don't fall under. So therefore, the internal link in this scenario is that states' rights are actually key to the enfranchisement of its own people, as Puerto Ricans are able to vote for not only the presidential election in the United States, but also further their political power in their own new state. So the impacts of this will be basically speaking up to the state allows people to actually uniquely consider their own value to life and therefore achieve a better quality of life and prevent this dehumanization that's occurring in the status quo.
So the order is going to be it's two disads, a solvency press, and that case. So I don't know how many sheets you might want for that, but the disads are both kind of long. Okay. Is everyone okay if I go kind of fast? Maybe I should have asked before.
I'll go slow if you're too fast.
Okay. Opponent's ready? Judge is ready. Alright, cool. The first disad is colonization. The first uniqueness point is that Puerto Rican culture is incredibly vibrant. Puerto Ricans pride themselves as having a unique and vibrant culture. This is really a key part that they look to as being really proud of this culture. The visa point is that less than half of citizens of U.S. citizens support statehood, saying that less than half of Puerto Rican citizens support statehood. They say that while we love our country and accept the association with the United States, we emphasize our loyalty to our culture, folklore, hospitality, and way of life. Notice the accept key. They don't welcome it, they accept it. The CISA point is that in the late 20th century there was a lot of tension over the United States modernizing, destroying their culture, capitalist exploitation, and the use of local workers as cheap migrant labor only aggravated the problem. And look to the fact that these problems are still going on today. The U.S. is still exploiting Puerto Rico, and it's really bad. All right, next is the links. The first link is cultural prostitution. To understand the implications of Puerto Rico as a state, we can look to another island nation that faced a similar predicament. This is Hawaii. To Americans, Hawaii is theirs, to use, to take, and to exploit. Here's a fact for you. Nearly 40 years ago, when statehood was first granted to Hawaii, residents outnumbered tourists 2-1. Today, the number of residents is 6-1, and Native Hawaiians by 30. Today, tourists outnumber residents by 6-1, and Native Hawaiians by 30-1. This is really bad. At the point at which we admitted Hawaii, it was literally just so that we could exploit their tourist industry, because we knew other people wanted to go to Hawaii just because they see it as a tropical paradise. Puerto Rico is roughly the same, like, level close to the equator geographically, and the, like, environment is roughly the same in Puerto Rico. The tourists, international tourists, are going to do the same. This is a huge disad to the case. Tourism has been the single most factor, in the crime rate. Tourists come to Puerto Rico and they literally break the laws in Puerto Rico because they think they can get away with it because they know the U.S. federal government is not going to enforce the laws because the U.S. federal government just sees Puerto Rico as a territory. There's no way that this is going to be solved by state incorporation either because this is Puerto Rico, I'll read more stuff about that later. Also, tourism economy encourages foreign investment and the cost of living. Encourages foreign investment and the cost of living goes up for the people living there. This exploitation is deferred to as cultural prostitution, because just as the prostitution industry exploits women, our government exploits for gain the local culture of Puerto Rico. Alright, the second link is that we will see this happen in Puerto Rico, which will turn their proud and unique culture into just another type of aloha industry. Alright, next is the impacts. The first impact is the exploitation of Puerto Ricans, similar to what we have seen. This is going to be really bad. This is going to cause the loss of local people through cause a loss of quality of life for the local people through gentrification. This also increases the crime rate and the destruction of the local business as the shift to the tourist industry happens. This also is going to completely destroy their culture. We saw this happen with Hawaiians. They literally just became the aloha industry. We completely suppressed their unique culture. The same thing is going to happen with Puerto Rico. Also, they impact out to dehumanization, but what's happening now is 1,000 times better than the dehumanization post-fiat. Alright, sorry, I misspoke in the roadmap. It's a counterplan and net benefits, not about the disad. Alright, that's the counterplan. The island of Puerto Rico should secede from the United States. This is mutually exclusive. Obviously, we can't admit them and have them secede at the same time. Solvency here. Lots of nations across Europe, Asia, and Africa prove this is possible. The Washington Post writes that Singapore, even though it is 14 times smaller than Puerto Rico, has less natural resources and a higher population density. They have thrived socially and economically since... I'll get it at the end. They have thrived socially and economically since gaining independence, and they have a higher per capita income than the United States. So this is cross-applied. This is a refutation to all of their econ impact. To all of their econ arguments, their economy is probably going to get a lot better once they secede. Yeah.
Status.
Unconditional. Alright, net benefits to the capital plan. First, the Puerto Rican government would be more readily able to protect the welfare and the rights of its people than the United States federal government is. Since the invasion of 1898, Washington, D.C. has only used Puerto Rico as a source of exploitation. But, look to examples of the Ponce Massacre, which was a peaceful demonstration until police opened fire because of U.S. federal government orders. The government also sanctions programs that forcibly sterilizing working class Puerto Rican women to unethical testing, and they literally perform human radiation experiments on the Puerto Rican prisoners that they capture. Also, Vieques is an island near Puerto Rico that is technically part of Puerto Rico, and we've been using it as target practice for our military, which has completely destroyed the island. That's really bad. Alright, the second net benefit is that the bad Puerto Rican economy is caused by the U.S. connection. This is a net benefit or a turn to the first advantage. It doesn't really matter. Declaring bankruptcy is only a short-term solution. The economy is literally limited by and dependent to Washington, D.C. U.S. federal laws and regulations are the reason that all of this economic degradation is happening, because they cannot get out from under the U.S. laws. So joining is not going to solve it. Solvency press. Statehood is a pipe dream. Hawaii and Alaska were both deemed incorporated territory before they were granted statehood. Puerto Rico is still classified as unincorporated territory, which means they belong to the United States, but they are not technically part of. This is really bad. This means that we are literally commodifying Puerto Rico and just using it to exploit it for our own purposes and gain. That's really bad. There's absolutely no way that Puerto Rico is going to join the United States, because they literally don't even have a necessary prerequisite to do it. All right, move on to case. They say net benefits. Net benefits is a bad framework, because it's a framework that made this type of exploitation of Puerto Rico possible, because we said, oh, we're going to hurt them, but it's all right because net benefit, it's going to be net beneficial to the United States. All right, and then on the first, on the first advantage of economy, they say that 45% of people are in poverty and that Puerto Rico has a lot of debt. This is because of U.S. regulations. They say that they can't file for bankruptcy, but bankruptcy is only a short-term solvency mechanism. They say that unemployment is high now. It's actually because of too strong regulation by the United States federal government. They say bankruptcy will be a bailout, but this is short-term. They say Biz will invest in Puerto Rico, but this is just more exploitation. The U.S. will get the money. The counterplan will be able to solve for this better, because the money of the tourism will literally go straight to Puerto Rico, not the United States taxing it on the jobs. Jobs will be come from out of state. This is bad. The increased quality of life, while it is, or just turn all of the stuff on increased quality of life to the first net benefit. Also, on the second advantage of democracy, the disad is the turn to this. You're going to see more solvency through the counterplan, and the U.S. will not represent it well. That was what all of the net benefits of the counterplan was.
percent CP, then our solvency, and then case. Is it all good?
Yeah.
All right. Starting time now. First, on the colonization disad, turn one. We stop Puerto Rican culture from being destroyed due to economic collapse at the point where the Puerto Rican economy is literally going to die right now because they are on the brink of bankruptcy. They are on the brink of collapse. Without a bailout option, they won't be able to survive. People will literally be dying in the streets because they can't afford anything and their economy is collapsing. If that happens, Puerto Rican culture doesn't survive. We preserve Puerto Rican culture by admitting it as a state and providing a short-term solution so that people can actually survive and the culture can actually thrive. Second term. Admitting Puerto Rico as a state can spread Puerto Rican culture in the United States at the point where, like, this has happened with Hawaii. Like, it's not that Puerto Rican culture is going to get destroyed. Like, it's going to spread across the United States because it's now a state and people can experience Puerto Rican culture. So, turn, we actually increase Puerto Rican culture. Yes.
Did that actually happen empirically when Hawaii or Alaska was admitted?
Yes, and also I'll go into why your impact is not unique. At the point where there's already tons of tourism in Puerto Rico, and you literally say that your net benefit is going to be tourism and that you're supporting tourism, then that means you link it to your own disadvantage. At the point where you talk about how, oh, tourism exploits these cultures, but then you say on your net benefit of your counterplan that tourism will be really good because it'll give Puerto Rico a bunch of money. Like, this literally links you into your own disadvantage. Also, it's not unique because there is tourism right now. Because there's tourism right now, we are exploiting culture. But we actually turn this, we decrease tourism at the point where we admit Puerto Rico as a state. People will see Puerto Rico as, they won't go to Puerto Rico as often because it's not seen as separate, no thank you. Which means that we actually decrease tourism by admitting it as a state. And if tourism is a link to colonization and we decrease that, then we decrease colonization. So yeah, and then the fourth turn is that there is solvency under minimum wage laws. Like, they talk about how, like, we're there's cheap labor and things like that, and, like, we're using these Puerto Ricans as, like, slave workers. Like, their solvency, once they're admitted into the United States, there are regulations, the minimum wage laws that the United States has to enforce, which means that these Puerto Ricans will actually be able to work and will actually be able to get, won't be oppressed by the capitalist structure because there are minimum wage laws that don't allow them to be cheap labor and basically slaves. So that's four terms. On the point, on the link level, they talk about how tourism increases the crime rate and when the US isn't there, like, this is probably a point supporting our side. Like, they literally say tourism increases the crime rate because people think that people think it's okay because the US isn't there, right? This literally is a point for our side at the point where they talk about how tourism exists right now, which already destroys culture because we're literally exploiting their culture for tourism. And we decrease tourism on the AF, which means we solve. And they say we're going to increase tourism, which only links them harder into their own disadvantage. And we literally solve for this because by having U.S. supervision, there will be less crime rate according to the NEG. So now to the CP. First argument is no solvency. They literally have no solvency for any of our advantages at the point where we specifically talk about the link level where the economy, like, they need a bailout, they need a reallocation of budget, and they need increased business investment under federal regulation. They have no solvency for economy or democracy because, like, their economy is going to crash. There's no bailout option because they're not being a state, and there's no right to vote because they're not a state. So their counterplan doesn't actually compete, and it doesn't solve for anything in this round, so it's not a unique reason why you're voting half down. Also, you can turn their counterplan. You literally destroy Puerto Rico at the point where you're just giving up on their economy. You're like, okay, their economy's gonna crash. Like, everyone's gonna, like, there's gonna be a massive default on debt. There's no possible way for them to get out, which means that that will cause an economic collapse in Puerto Rico and destroy lives and destroy culture and destroy quality of life in Puerto Rico. The only possible way to solve is the AF plan, and your counterplan only furthers this impact. So on the net benefits, they again talk about tourism. They talk about how tourism will be going directly to Puerto Rico at the point where they're increasing tourism and making it seem more like exotic and stuff like that by separating from the United States. People will go there more. There will be more tourism. There will be more exploitation of exploitation of culture, which means they link directly into their own disadvantage. So at the end of the day, I have four terms on their colonization. Like, they literally don't do anything. They literally make things worse. And our affirmative plan makes things better, and we actually spread Puerto Rican culture instead of letting it die due to an economic collapse, and the counterplan has no solvency. Now onto our solvency sheet. So they talk about how, oh, statehood is a pipe dream, and, like, the Puerto Rican is still unincorporated, and we're commodifying Puerto Rico. Like, we solve for this, right? Like, they talk about how Puerto Rico right now is seen as unincorporated, seen as separate from the United States. So if we accept it as part of the United States, then we solve for that, right? And, like, they can't say we don't solve at the point where U.S. is literally, like, they say solvency press. You can't accept Puerto Rico as a state. Like, that's just not true. The Congress can pass a law. It's done it many times in the past. So the solvency press makes no sense. Then they talk about how our criterion is bad and how net benefits is bad, but they don't provide any other alternative to weigh this debate on. There's no other criterion, there's no other role of the ballot, which means you have to weigh it under net benefits. They'd say, oh, net benefits is so bad, but their disadvantage and counterplan functions under net benefits, which means that they link into that too, so that makes no sense. Now to our case about the economy. They say, oh, this is caused by U.S. connection. That's completely false. My partner specifically mentions about how the Puerto Rico government is exempt from all these regulations of the U.S. of the economy, which means that because the U.S. is not involved, because the U.S. is separate from Puerto Rico, it's gone into this debt because of this massive like foreign investment and inability to pay back their debt. They say, oh, this is only a short-term solution. Your plan is only a short-term solution. That doesn't matter. At the point where we prevent an economic collapse that allows Puerto Rico to recover, we need a short-term solution. Otherwise, you'll never actually solve. There's no other alternative. There's no other alternative solution besides providing this bailout for Puerto Rico. Otherwise, the Puerto Rico economy will collapse now, right? You say it's a short-term solution. Exactly. We have to have a short-term solution or else their culture is going to get destroyed and their value of life is going to be destroyed. So at the end of the day, like, their refutation makes no sense. They say, like, the econ is caused by U.S. connection, which is completely false, but even if it is caused by U.S. connection, we still solve for the economic crisis, right? We still allow them to have a bailout, we still provide jobs, and we still stop the dehumanization that's happening in Puerto Rico, right? They endorse this economic collapse. They say, just let go of Puerto Rico. Like, we don't even care about them. Their economy is going to die. All this dehumanization and quality of life and culture is going to get destroyed, which means that there's clear net benefits for the app side at the point where we turn their entire disadvantage multiple times, and their counterplan is just not competitive at all because it doesn't actually, there's no net benefit, it doesn't solve for our app case, so it doesn't, it's not a unique reason why you're voting neg. Thank you.
So it's going to be DA, counterplan, and then on to the optimization of solvency. Solvency and before up. Okay, ready? Starting my time now. The first thing we need to look to this round is their four turns. These four turns clearly have some major logical problems that we have to look to first before you can evaluate this. Let's go on the first one. Their first turn is they say, we stop Puerto Rican economic collapse, which is, if there's an economic collapse, it's going to completely destroy culture. First of all, culture like transcends economic collapse. In times of economic crisis, people use culture and national identity as a way to motivate themselves and push through struggle. We can look to, there's been a multitude of economic collapses all around the world, and all of them have not led to a complete destruction of their culture. That's not going to happen. America has gone through multiple economic collapses. There's still culture. We still have a cultural identity. That's what happens. Culture transcends the economy. That turn, don't buy that. Culture is going to continue. The second one, they talk about how admitting the Puerto Rican will spread Puerto Rican culture, and they say, look to Hawaii, for example. We have Hawaiian culture all across America. Okay, this is not true. We brutalize their culture, and we make a vague, like, what seems to be what our idea of a culture is, and use it. It's nothing more than a replica of their culture. Do you really think Hawaiian culture is nothing but, like, luaus and coconuts and all that stuff? No, that's because we destroyed their culture and made it seem like that's the entirety of their culture. We completely ignored the entirety of their culture, and that's exactly what we're going to do to the Puerto Rican people. We're going to brutalize their culture and make it nothing more than a sham, and then promote that. That's what happens when you destroy someone's culture. That's what happens when you engage in cultural prostitution.
Most people don't even know who King Kamehameha is, who is like a huge part of their culture.
Yes. Do any of you know King Kamehameha? You might know. I don't know. King Kamehameha is? Yeah. My judges might know that. But the thing is, we tend to ignore the thing. We know nothing but Hawaii, but what, like, is tourism. We don't know the identity. We don't know the Hawaiian gods and the story behind that. We don't know anything like that because we brutalize their culture. Don't buy that term. Okay. Let's move on.
What's your impact for culture?
I'll get to that. Are you asking why culture is important?
Yeah, term of impact.
No. He's asking what your impact is on your business.
I'll get to that when I'm done.
Does this impact?
Yeah. Let's go to the third one about minimum wage. We're gonna basically turn the turn because this is actually wrong. The United States minimum wage is the root cause of the economic problems that's currently existing in Puerto Rico. We implemented a $7 minimum wage on Puerto Rico, and what this did is, since the goods and services are actually very cheap in Puerto Rico, it made it a lot more challenging for people to pay low-paying jobs because the minimum wage is so high because we're holding them to the standards of the United States. This led to mass unemployment, which is the cause of the economic collapse. Minimum wage caused the economic collapse. It's not the solution. Okay. Now their next thing is they have this whole idea that in the one NC, my partner is promoting some sort of like increase in tourism. All he said on tourism was that the tourism that's existing now goes towards the Puerto Rican government. He's not saying
and the Puerto Rican
and the Puerto Rican people. We're not saying that we're going to increase tourism. We're not fiating that. I don't know where they got the idea that we're going to increase tourism. We're stopping an increase in tourism, and we're stopping like the clear. Just support of the government onto this tourism. So as you can see from those four turns, none of them have any real ground. They're either logically flawed or just simply wrong. So let's go to the impacts. As they just asked in their question, they asked a very simple thing. What's the importance of culture? What's the importance of culture? Your culture is your identity. When you are born, you identify with everything what's in your state. Your statehood, your national identity is who you are as a son of a person. Me growing up in America, I have certain things that shape me as a human. When you destroy someone's culture, you destroy their ontological being. You destroy part of their existence. When you take away from them that. That's what happens. We see that plenty of times, anytime there's sort of exploitation, and cultural loss always leads to some sort of genocide or something like that. It's just as bad. You're destroying the existence of people. They say it's a systemic issue. They might come up here and say, oh, culture is not as important as econ. But it is. Culture is more important than econ, because once, like as I brought up in the beginning of the speech, it's going to transcend all that stuff. It's one of the things that essentially defines who we are as humans. Also, the links flow through here, which means that since we've clearly proven that those turns aren't effective, we get all the impacts. The negation gets access to the impacts of the fact that you're basically kicking people out of the government, out of their country. Oh, actually, I also have something to bring up on the fact that they said they're not going to increase tourism. We specifically read in the first speech that in Hawaii, using Hawaii as an example, the local citizens outnumber them 2-1, and then 40 years later, they outnumber the tourists outnumber local citizens 6-1, and like actually native Hawaiians of the ethnic group, like the Hawaiian people, 30-1. For every native Hawaiian, there is 30 tourists. That's what's gonna happen.
We're gonna argue that tourism is gonna go up once.
Tourism, to like as you can see, empirical evidence is the exact same situation as my partner brought up like multiple times. It will go up. This is kind of fun.
Yeah.
Okay, on to the counterplan. They say that we don't solve for the advantage one or advantage two. On the let's actually like look at both of these. First, on the advantage one, we say once they get out, their economy will be better. My partner brought up actually multiple reasons for this. He brought up the example of Singapore that was unrefuted, so to mind that. On the second advantage, they will vote for themselves, not as policymakers. Instead of incorporating into the United States and saying that they're going to vote for United States senators, the counterplan says they will vote for their own government, which solves the democracy advantage.
We get just as much solvency.
We meet the advantage one and advantage two, and we get the advantage, like the whole net benefits of, you know, not destroying their culture, which I think might be important. Okay. I already answered their thing about CP with tourism. So basically, what we're increasing tourism. I already answered that. So what we're seeing is we're getting the fact that, like, on the net benefits advantage, that Econ Limited and is dependent on Washington, that should flow through. And the fact that the United States federal laws and regulations is actually a cause of economic problem, and we're solving that by breaking free. So we get that, and we get the solvency under their advantage. Let's move on to the first advantage of Econ. They talk about how it's not true because the PR is exempt from regulation. No, they're not. They have the United States federal government minimum wage. Look to that and lots of other regulation. They say that like a short-term solution is good. That's not true. That's never true. When we have a short-term solution, what we see is, especially in systemic issues like this, it's always going to come back, and problems like that are always going to come back. And the problem is rooted in the fact of the connection between the United States. If we break that, we break the systemic issue, and we see long-term solution. That's just another example of how we're solving that. Look to the fact that, like the arguments of war exploitation and all that stuff, were simply only refuted with the fact that a whole thing, like the tourism misconception. So basically, the arguments on this should flow through. On the second one, the DA should turn this. They talk about like the disenfranchisement. You're basically just disenfranchising them more. You're brutalizing their culture and doing all that stuff. So you don't buy this. You're not creating more democracy. You're destroying it. You're destroying the rights of the native people. And look to Hawaii once again. You're eventually removing the native people through gentrification. So I'm not actually even going to go on the solvency thing, but judge, there's a lot of stuff you can vote on this round. Vote for the fact that they're fine with destroying the culture of the Puerto Rican people.
Out of these impacts later on in the round. We've refuted all of the turns. There's absolutely no offense that they have other than those turns, and those turns aren't even going to flow through because Conlon refuted all of them. Just extend the culture transcends economy. Brutalized culture is nothing but brutalizing culture is like nothing but a replica, all that stuff. So extend all of those turn answers. There's absolutely no way that they're going to be able to get out of like those turn answers. There's no offense that they're going to be gaining off of this, so that at the end of the day on the colonization, you're only going to be seeing our impacts at the bottom of the flow. Also, they don't respond to links, which means we are going to get 100% chance of solvency on these impacts, so I'll be explaining why that's important in the voters. Next, go on to the counterplan. Just first note that the counterplan, there's no perm on the counterplan, obviously, because it's mutually exclusive, but really the only thing that they attack on the counterplan is that it's not solving for their advantages. We explain why it solves for the advantage one, because we make all of these arguments, which are from the Washington Post, saying that like all of this economic like downfall that's happening in Puerto Rico right now is because of too strong U.S. regulations. In fact, I make an argument on case that goes unrefuted on the fourth uniqueness point on the first advantage. I make a turn that it's because of too strong regulations, which they don't respond to. So at that point, you're going to be gaining that we're 100% solving for their advantage one by like having them secede from the United States, and we're solving for their advantage two. It's just like in a different way. They're just voting for Puerto Rican like senators and stuff instead of U.S. senators. There's no way that that's solving less. Okay, and then the only other argument was that the counterplan is increasing tourism. Conlon already did a pretty good job of responding to that, so I don't really need to. Just note on the second net benefit of the economy, they don't respond to the fact that the economy is limited by and dependent on Washington, and that it's because of U.S. federal laws and regulations that are causing all of that. They don't actually make an argument specifically against that second net benefit, which is going to mitigate their solvency on the first advantage. All right. Move on to on case. Like I already said, mitigate solvency on the first advantage. There's really no, at the end of the day, the impacts, the only thing that they have is an increase in quality of life, but we proved to you how that goes down. We proved to you how that goes down even more when they join the United States because of the cultural prostitution argument. Also, they don't respond to the fact that that there's just going to be more exploitation once they join into the United States. We give you empirical evidence about Hawaii that they don't have any counter to. At the point at which you're seeing more exploitation once they join the United States and more exploitation of their tourism industry, that's probably bad. Under no circumstance does the counterplan increase tourism. It's probably more like the other way around because of the statistics that we give you about Hawaii. So you're going to be buying that. It's empirical evidence that they don't have an answer to. And then on the second advantage of democracy, it's kind of a wash because we're both solving for it. All right, move on to voters. First, we're winning the colonialism disad, and this is going to basically win us the round. At the point at which you're seeing cultural loss, that's going to be a huge impact because they have absolutely no way of solving for the cultural loss. The only thing that they can possibly say is that they're going to join into the United States and they're going to get all the fantastic U.S. culture. That's probably pretty bad. Like Puerto Rican culture, we make all the arguments, all of our uniqueness arguments about how they pride themselves on having a very vibrant culture, which they don't really respond to. At the point at which you're destroying their culture, that's going to be really bad because it's literally a sense of pride for them. At the point at which you're taking out a sense of pride for an entire people, that's definitely really bad and dehumanizing. So we're going to outweigh on magnitude alone. Also, cultural loss is a systemic impact. They say we should terminalize this. In the question, they say, what's the terminal impact? We don't have a terminal impact. It's a systemic impact. You're going to evaluate systemic impacts over terminalized impacts because they're a lot more probable. We're winning on probability. Systemic impacts transcend generations. That's a lot more probable than like a long shot econ collapse and terminalized impact. Systemic impacts happen, they're happening right now. An economic collapse has not happened for all of the last 3 years. The Puerto Rico's economy has been pretty bad, but a systemic impact is 100% guaranteed to happen because it's already happening. Vote on systemic impacts first because they affect multiple generations and they just absolutely destroy the value to life of those people. And at the point at which you destroy the value to life of someone, that makes genocide of that people a lot more likely to happen because you see those people as less than human. That's a necessary precondition for all forms of oppression and genocide. So like I already said, the second advantage that they have of democracy is a wash. Pretty much the only thing that they might be able to go for is econ collapse, but I already explained why the dissat is going to outweigh that. At the point at which you're seeing systemic impacts evaluated over terminalized impacts, that's probably an egg ballot. So for these reasons, vote nay.
On the first case trend, they just mentioned how culture even transcends economic collapse, and there's going to be no complete destruction, but they give you no warrant for this. As far as we know, they're doing nothing for the economy. So right now what we see is that the direct impact of their action is that people are literally going to be dying in the street, right? They're just saying, oh man, culture is going to still exist, but people are going to be dying in the streets, right? 45% of them are already in poverty, and the next just saying, oh, just do nothing, let people die. And when people die, there's no culture, right? Let me extend what my partner said. If people are dead, you straight up have no culture because you're dead, right? So their culture is literally going to die off when you do nothing for the economy, right? It's literally dying off because of their counterplan, because these people are going to die because there's no economic support, as the country's already in $72 million of debt. So therefore, we still get this case turn, there's going to be this collapse, and the culture is going to be lost because people are going to die, and people have culture, and when that's lost, we turn your own impact. Onto the second turn. And they just mentioned how culture is destroyed in Hawaii. They just mentioned, there's pretty generic stuff that you know about culture, but they didn't say why culture can't spread. No reason why culture can't spread. They just said, some stuff about Hawaii, but culture can still spread. They've conceded that culture can still spread from Puerto Rico to the United States. Just saying that a little bit, that's still culture spreading, right? So we still get access to this turn moving further down. On our other turn, non-unique, there's going to be less tourism with our plan as it's seen as separate. But first of all, on this whole DA as a whole, you can extend their analysis in the uniqueness, which says that tourism already exists in the in Puerto Rico due to the U.S. influence, right? Culture is being destroyed right now, which makes their DA completely non-unique. Again, my partner mentioned, their whole DA is non-unique. You can straight up extend their uniqueness, which says culture is being destroyed right now by U.S. tourists. Completely not unique, right? They're not doing anything for this. And if anything, tourism's still gonna exist, and it might go up if Puerto Rico's seen as a more exotic country. And also on 4, they mentioned how all these restrictions on minimum wage are actually extremely bad for the Puerto Rican economy right now, and this is why there's such high unemployment. What they're literally advocating for here is that people should work as slaves for this capitalist system. Like my partner talked about, these restrictions prevent people from working for very low wages and essentially being slaves for these for these business interests. But then they're saying, these regulations are really bad, and this is the reason why we need to get rid of the U.S. in order to actually employ more people. They're not quality jobs.
I don't know about the judges, but I don't have that reputation anywhere on my flow saying that minimum wage prevents the capitalist machine.
Okay, my partner articulates on the econ ed that laws prevent exploitation.
It's also just a term.
Yeah, it's a term.
Point under consideration.
Yeah, so basically it's a straight turn towards their deregulation. So if anything, you can extend my partner's prior analysis, people are just going to be working as slaves for this business system, with their deregulation, and there's no reason why culture can't spread. So first, their DA is completely non-unique, and second, we just completely turn this, as they're only going to make the situation worse by letting people straight up die. Onto the CP. On the CP, they just added this extra plank. I'm not sure if it was in their original articulation, which was Puerto Rico should secede, but they added this plank, oh, they can vote for their own democracy, like, not in the text, but, like, even addressing this, like, democracies mirror the U.S., right? They're not going to escape the U.S. influence, which makes their CP non-unique, because it's not going to do anything unique for Puerto Rico, as democracies that mirror the U.S. will still have the same influence, which means that tourism still didn't exist, so there's no benefit for the CP, and the only impact of the CP is that people are literally going to die, because there's no aid, and there's no statehood for Puerto Rico. Onto this, like, they're not solving for the economy whatsoever. They absolutely don't solve for our app. They don't provide any example of how, like, they're not gonna solve outside of tourism. They're just saying, oh, we're not gonna endorse tourism at all. So, like, what industry is gonna exist? Like, they don't access our expanding of the businesses in our first app whatsoever. Like, that's great. Maybe with your CP, you can have your own democracy, but, like, you're not gonna be able to escape US influence. So now onto impact weighing. The impacts in this round are obviously systemic. Like, terminal impacts are basically what the final, like, result of the impacts are essentially in this round. So, like, there's no differentiation between terminal impacts and systemic impacts. Regardless, we solve for both. Let's look on net benefits. They didn't provide us a different, like, counter criteria to evaluate in this debate. So we should be evaluating the suffering of people equally with this loss of culture, which is still going to cause, right? So looking at the impacts in this round, what are the impacts of our first ad, right? The impacts of our first ad is that we're able to actually save these Puerto Ricans that literally don't have jobs and that they have to decide between food and medicine, like, so we can actually keep them alive. So that's obviously a net benefit, and the systemic impact that we're able to solve is actually poverty in Puerto Rico. Again, 45% of Puerto Ricans are in poverty, right? We're not decreasing regulations so people work for, like, even lower wages. Like, that would be only making the systemic issue worse. Like, they're trying to advocate for it. So, like, we solve for the systemic issue. We solve for poverty, right? We terminalize our impacts of lives because people won't be losing their lives as there's actual economic support from the United States, which their CP simply doesn't offer. So at the end of the day, high magnitude impacts come first. Like, we avoid this economic collapse that will prevent this loss of culture. Thank you.